Morning. Hi, my name is Matt. For some of you, I haven't been here the last couple Sundays. It's given me a chance to celebrate with my son down at a Minnesota Twins game, spend some time up in the Boundary Waters. I'm grateful to be back amongst my people, and I'm grateful to be here this morning, worshiping with all of you who are here in person or those of you who are worshiping with us through our broadcast partners. We have a couple quick announcements. First of all, thank you to John and Kay Johnson, who are sponsoring our worship broadcast this morning, and a note that all are welcome to join us after worship today in the fellowship hall for our coffee fellowship hour. Please note the invitation in our bulletin and announcement page this morning. The invitation from Judy Page and her family for a casual gathering to celebrate the life of Jerry Page this Tuesday from 4 to 6 at Tiana Country Club. And today is your last chance to purchase a ticket to win the bench handcrafted by Hope's own Carl Berg. That's located out in the entryway. And Danielle, are you willing to sell tickets for 5 minutes after worship? That's your last shot, okay? So after those, after worship, Carl, we're good. Okay, and then Carl, we'll have Carl come out at that point, and we'll have Carl draw a winning ticket, and we'll find out who gets to bring that beautiful bench home. And we have a temple talk from the Women of Hope this morning. Shirley.
Good morning. Good morning. Michelle has done a very great job here on putting most of what we need in the bulletin today. So if you just hang on to that bulletin as we get nearer to our Christmas in July, you will find areas where you can help. I'm just going to add a couple things. For those of you who are in the working force but would be able to bring a salad for our salad luncheon, the church is open at 7:30 on Tuesday morning, the day of the sale, and you could perhaps drop your salad off on your way to work or whatever, because we need 80 plus salads, so we need a lot of salads. And for the bake sale, one other thing, if you bring a pie that has a double crust, could you please identify the pie? It's hard for us to know what kind of pie it is without sticking our fingers in it and trying to figure out what it is. So yeah, if you could just identify that pie. And plants, we need to know the name of the plant, whether it's an annual or perennial, and if it needs sun or shade. We're not all real familiar with plants when they come in, and so if you can help us out in that way, that would be good. And of course, we need workers. Gentlemen, we need workers on Monday, and we need workers on Tuesday. About 8:30 in the morning on Monday morning, we need help setting everything up. And then on Tuesday, about 1:30, we need you to help put everything back where we drug it out from. So if you could help, that would be great. We just need people to sign up so that we know how many salads we've got coming, how many workers we have coming, and so forth. So today, I will be out there with you in the narthex, and I will have sign-up sheets if you want to come and stop and sign up for whatever. Otherwise, the sign-up sheets are on the women's bulletin board, which is down the hall that way, just beyond the bathrooms. And you can sign up anytime. They're up there during the week. So just thank you so much for any help you can give us. We certainly appreciate it.
Thank you, Shirley. Just a couple other quick notes. Our youth have been bagging groceries at Super One all weekend. Today from 10 to noon is our last opportunity for that. They're taking tips to help them go to camp this summer. And we plan to worship outdoors next Sunday, but we haven't hit the weather lottery yet. It's been rain and cold on Sunday mornings when we've done that. So please know that even if the weather doesn't look good to worship outdoors, then we will move indoors and worship inside our sanctuary. That's all I got. Worship continues. Please rise. We gather as we worship in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thank you. We confess together, O God, sin binds us, our words, our hands, our feet, and our whole being. Individually, we harm the lives of our neighbors, knowingly and unknowingly. Collectively, we participate in systems that oppress some and ignore others. We look to ourselves and not you. Forgive us, we pray. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ might live in your hearts through faith. And all the people said, Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. Almighty and merciful God, we implore you to hear the prayers of your people. Be our strong defense against all harm and danger, that we may live and grow in faith and hope through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. I invite the kids forward for our Kids Minute. Morning, Brooklyn. High five. Morning. One more. Ow! You know, Brooklyn, sometimes you give high fives and they're so powerful that it kind of hurts, right? And so sometimes when we get hurt, we might pray or to God, we might ask our moms or dads to help, right? And when we're hurt and we get better, we call that healing, right? Okay, so how many of us have had a cut before or a scrape? Have you ever had that? Okay, and healing, you know, if you got a scrape, right, you get kind of a scab, right? And then pretty soon, it's better, right? And that's like physical healing. But did you know that there's other kinds of healing as well? Let's think about it this way. You know, I've shared this is pretty common knowledge, but I, when I was a kid, and maybe still, really afraid of the dark. Okay, have you ever went on a dark night and you have to get something from outside, turn on the light, grab a flashlight, and then go outside, and then just looking around, that's how I feel. You ever felt that way? You run really fast, go out, get the thing, and then run back inside the house. It's like, whew, ever felt that way? Yeah? So fear sometimes affects us in that way. And so have you ever thought about being healed from our fears? Have you ever thought about that way? Like if you're, no, yeah. So sometimes we need to be healed of our fear. And one of the things that helped me when I was younger was mom and dad, right? If mom came out with me or dad was outside with me, that helped a lot. Or sometimes, you know, there are things that happen that just make us sad, right? We get big tears, right? And sometimes friends, when friends hang out with us, they turn that frown upside down, right? and our friends help to heal our sadness, right? And that's one of the things that as a church and as a community, all of these people help us heal in all kinds of different ways, right? When you get a scrape on our knee, and mom or dad might say, oh, we got to put some Bactine on that, and that's going to sting, right? But then it gets better. Okay? And we gather as brothers and sisters and as the family of God to get healing too. Healing of our hearts and of our sadness and those kind of things too. You know what helps heal my heart a lot? Is seeing all y'all smile and play and have fun and just have joy in life. I think that helps to heal all of our hearts. So thanks for also being a part of the healing work of God. Can we say a prayer? Okay. Dear God, thanks for kids, for the ways that they heal our hearts. Thank you for the way that you work through family and your family on this earth. Help to work your healing through our work and through our words. All this we pray in Jesus' name, and all God's kids whispered as quietly as they could. Amen. Awesome. Thanks all for coming up, and you can have a few of those. Go ahead and make sure you grab a few, and you can share those with certainly share those with brothers, sisters, cousins, anyone who might be a little too big to come up for kids' messages these days. So that's okay. Yep. All right, you can head back to your seats. Thanks for coming up.
Thank you, kids. Our first lesson comes from Lamentations, chapter 3. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for one to bear the yoke in youth, to sit alone in silence when the Lord has imposed it, to put one's mouth to the dust, there may yet be hope, to give one's cheek to the smiter, to be filled with insults. For the Lord will not reject forever. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion, according to the abundance of his steadfast love, for he does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second lesson comes from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, the second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 8. Now, as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you may be rich. And in this matter, I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something, now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it in according to your means. Completing it according to your means. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance. As it is written, the one who had much did not have too much, and the one who had little did not have too little. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 5th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. You'll notice today a common occurrence in the Gospels. We get a healing story sandwiched in the middle of a healing story. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came, and when he saw him, he fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So Jesus went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say who touched me?" He looked all around to see who had done it, but the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader Jairus' house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." They laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. And he strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Our preaching text this morning is our gospel reading. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Amen. How would you define faith? What faith is? Most might respond with words like belief or trust. Those who are listening during Sunday school or church classes might even remind us that faith is a gift from God, that without God we wouldn't be able to believe or trust. Now, embedded in these common words, belief and trust, are images of those who appear to unwaveringly believe, whose confident trust in God sometimes seems to almost defy our human tendency to doubt and to wonder. When I picture people with this kind of faith, I think of my grandma, who played organ for God knows how long in her little country church in North Dakota. Perhaps you have some people that had a faith like that, unwaveringly trusting and believing. Like Joseph, son of Jacob, who despite being sold into slavery by his brothers, falsely accused and thrown into prison for 2 years, seems to trust God unconditionally. And there's nothing wrong with this brand of faith. That brand of faith that would look death in the face and laugh. But today we are introduced to another definition of faith. One rarely lifted up as a model, but perhaps is more grounded in the human experience. And more common than the church through the centuries might like to admit. And this definition goes like this: exhausted desperation. You see, amidst the crowds who pressed in on Jesus was a woman. And scripture, which so often leaves out details, especially when it comes to women, tells us quite a lot about her. She's been suffering from a disease for 12 years. Now, there are many diseases that people would have in those days that would have allowed her to continue practicing her faith and gathering with the community. But there were two in particular that would require her to remain separate from the community, separate from being able to practice her faith: leprosy and bleeding disorders like hers. Like we would for those that we love, the best care was sought out. We're told that she endured much under many physicians, being poked and prodded and examined. And here, in this community, we have many who have battled cancer, diseases of your own. And you know this experience of running from one doctor to another, being poked and prodded and examined. And yet her disease did not get better, but instead, we're told, grew worse. In the end, she had spent everything that she had. No better off than she'd been over a decade before. I know that for some of us in this room, those listening to the broadcast, this has been, and this is your experience. Spent of all other options, exhausted, desperate, she pressed through the crowds, reaching out for the one she'd heard about named Jesus. Hoping against hope, having exhausted all other avenues, she reached, hoping that the healing power he had demonstrated among others might emanate from him into her. And as she stretched out her finger one last time, and as it brushed his cloak, suddenly the symptoms of her disease ceased. And Jesus addressed her exhausted and desperate faith. Your faith has made you whole. When we think about it, do you think Jairus, whose 12-year-old daughter was near death, do you think his faith was any less desperate? Or the faith behind those battling themselves today, and the family who supports them, seeking any and all avenues of treatments, doctors, exhausting financial resources along the way? Do you think because their faith might not always appear strong, unwaveringly trusting, instead holding just to a thread of hope, that faith is any less authentic and true and faithful, stretching out to catch even a wisp of the power of God. Little over a decade ago, a neighbor of the congregation I served walked into my office admitting he never really believed in God. Hadn't attended worship in years, except for his wife's funeral, which was about 5 years prior. And had struggled to trust what the church institution tried to teach him in his younger years. As he opened up about his life, I heard the struggles of grief that he'd been bearing those previous 5 years, and how he'd been through the ringer since, battling cancer himself and countless rounds of chemo and treatment, all along losing ground in his battle. Without children and facing the mounting medical bills, he had recently had to sell his house and took up residence in a nearby apartment building. And he came in that day to introduce himself and to tell me he was going to give God a try, because it appeared that nothing else was working. And he started showing up on Sunday mornings for worship, and popping in here and there throughout the week. It was about 6 months later as I visited him in his hospice bed, knowing the end of his battle was drawing near. And as we prayed and read scripture and visited, he looked over and said, "Coming to church was the best decision I ever made. Though my prayer didn't take away my cancer, the care and the love and the food from the women and the community, all that you all have shared with me," he said, "in here," pointing to his heart, "here, I am healed." Thanks be to God for God's emanating healing power in his cloak and in his community that meets us in faith, no matter how we define it. Amen. Please rise as we sing together our hymn of the day. And now, together with the whole church on earth, let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Gathered together by the Holy Spirit, let us lift our prayers for the church, the world, and all those in need. God of abundance, though the crowds pressed upon you, you never wearied in bringing healing and wholeness. We pray for all who call on your name, that others might get to know you because of what we say and what we do. Lord, in your mercy, God of justice, you reign in steadfast love. Bring peace between nations ravaged by war or strife, and illumine paths of justice and freedom for those who lead them. Especially we pray for the Holy Land, Ukraine and Russia, and our own nation. Lord, in your mercy, God of compassion, your touch brings healing and your word revives us for life. Hear our prayers for Jimmy Kellogg, Chuck Prefrock, Bob Ritter, Christine Opine, Al Moss, Dale and Harriet Jones, Linda Weeks, Linda Smith, Bev Wooster, Sherry Kisa, Dee Jensen, Gail Bauman, Tom, Kari, and Kristen. We give thanks, too, for doctors, nurses, and caregivers who attend to the needs of others. Transform wailing into dancing and weeping into joy. Lord, in your mercy. God of community, you gather us at your table of plenty. Where there is hunger among us, open our hands. Where we are indifferent to the needs of others, open our hearts. Where loneliness lingers, lead us to accompany others into belonging. Lord, in your mercy. God of creation, you appointed us to steward the earth. We praise you for the gift of water. We clap our hands for the variety of creatures and plants, the majesty of the mountains. Lead us to honor you in our stewardship. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, to you we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to share that peace with one another. The Lord be with you. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered together by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. For those gathered around tables in your own home where you've gathered the elements of bread and wine or juice, I now encourage you to extend the words of promise to one another. For those who are gathered at those tables with us but alone in your place, I offer now these words to you. The body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. For those gathered here at Hope, we practice open communion, which means all are welcome to receive at Christ's table of mercy and grace. We'll commune this morning at two stations in the front in a continuous manner. All of our bread is gluten-free, and grape juice is available for those who have that need. Come now, for all is prepared. Thank you. Please rise in body and spirit. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. And now receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing together our closing hymn, I'm So Glad Jesus Lifted Me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me.
Now, people of God, let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God goes with us, and this changes everything.